that in Thailand, the process has been very similar. But then now, after the military takeover, so the situation now, then the people's discontent could be contained, or it is only being suppressed?
The military don't touch. They try to they don't suppress the movement which no they don't. But because the military saw the development of conflict to that level, so military try to justify its existence as to contain the and to reconcile the conflicts between the two camps. So in Thailand, because the military is gone, and not military, so government is gone after coup d'etat. So the military present itself as a third party in solving the issue. That is a good easy solution. Yeah, easy solution, but problematic, big problem.
How about the because I think the underlying problem is the economic problem. There have been the so this is not resolved through the, or is the government doing something new to, for example, give to the poor or give to the farmers? Or will the constitutional reform be only basically at the political level? I mean, are they addressing the economic issues?
I think this is the challenge. Mm-hmm. This is a challenge.
Yes.
Yeah. They how far the government, how far the constitution will accommodate the issue of structural inequalities, and how, in what way that is open.
What's developing in the situation in Thailand, been affecting you, your personal work, or in any way?
Sure, it affect, because we have to adapt, we have to adapt how we work with people. It affect more the political environment. It frames the limits of freedom for the public and for the people who want to voice their views and demonstrate their causes. This really have the effect. Yeah.
Surichai, we would like to hear your life story.
Yes, so I just, yes, I am very honored, yes.
No, because I am sure it will be very inspiring for, especially for the younger generation. And so, when you talk, you
you have a strong emphasis on the question of being of human, of human emotions relating to each other in a human way. Has that to do with Buddhism, or with the way some kind of influence in your childhood or when you were studying? Because I think you stressed very often that we should have in a very human way of relating.
Yes, I think maybe influenced by Buddhism, maybe because Buddhism emphasizes that human is not just animals that have feelings and needs and wants, but human need some kind of training or some kind of consideration that it can increase its own capacity to understand and to deal with life and people and environment and other, especially Buddhist is concerned also about how human relates with environment of other beings and the nature. So in that sense, maybe just because these days we seem to be too egoistic, we seem to be too concerned about what we want from the world, and it makes us often blind to many issues. And I think by being blind to these fundamental issues of living with other beings or with the environment make us more unstable, more unsustainable. So I think oftentimes we seem not to be aware because of competition, because of our focus in making money or making achievement or whatever. Yeah. So maybe that is the part. So at least we should find ways to just talk to people to hear what other things is going on. So I think human is just a part of all these living things in the world. So maybe that is Buddhism. Yeah.
I think you said that you went to study in the monastery.
Oh, yes.
When you maybe you can tell us that story.
Oh, I see. I went to you see in because I am from a rural village in a place in not in Bangkok but in Lumpur. So in our rural tradition, it is expected, or it is a good thing to do, is to become a monk for some period of your life. To become a monk is to train yourself to be educated and also give some consideration to yourself, your inner self. This part, Buddhism has some element that make the local customs defined. So in Thai rural areas, mainly every man before marriage should go to temple and becoming a monk for a period. But I was not in that I was not able to do that. So I only became a monk when I was already some 30 years old, after working at the university, so I found some period around 88 or 89, that I went to the temple. My mother was most happy because I think our parents are expecting that this is something good for everyone, and also a way to you know, to make merit for our you know, grand parents or whatever. I mean, that kind of thinking, and also for ourselves. So that means we 3 months plus, right, in the rainy season is the period of very important for that kind of choice. So it was in a temple about some 10 kilometers away from my home in Lamphun, and that temple also can come to beg for food in the morning sometimes in our area. So that temple was quite convenient, and it's also a temple where we have a good meditation training monk. So that incidentally, that temple, I also learned later that it has a very good relationships in terms of arts and culture, architecture, etc., with the northern culture in relation to Shan people in Burma. And because you see, it's just continental, you only can walk across the border, and these were just lands that were sharing same rule of kings in some hundred, some thousand years ago. So in a way, I was discovering that kind of relationships too. And the monk who was taking, he was my mentor, he knew very well this part of cultural relationships with the other neighboring peoples, and who live in the lower part of China, northeastern part of Burma, like that. So that was also something to discover. Sorry.
But did you go to school also in the monastery?
Oh yes, my school, the name is already temple. It's called Rung Rien Wat Ban Kong. So Wat is a temple, Ban Kong is name of the temple, is a name. So it is a school, temple school is called Ban Kong Temple School, like that. Yes. Later they changed it to a more a nicer name. They dropped the word dropped the word Wat Temple, and they also make it more beautiful, more Sanskrit. So it changed to, but still people call it Rung Rien Ban Kong, Rung Rien Ban Kong. But it is still situated in the same compound with the temple. And these days, because of a legal person idea, the running of the school become separated, and it has been given land by the temple, so it becomes a completely a different entity.
What does Ban Gong mean?
Ban Gong mean Ban is a village. Gong, I think it is just maybe it may it's like a resounding noise or something like that, huh? Like maybe it like echo or something like that, huh? So maybe because people can shout and or if the make the what you call the drums, big drums, and the drum sound can go far, so it's make the noise resounding, so they call it, they just call it Ban Gong in that sense. Huh? Mm.
Is it equivalent when you went there? Was it for primary school?
It's primary, it's primary, yeah. It's primary. At the moment, it has developed into middle school now, yes, yes. Mm.
So you were from the rural, so your parents were farmers?
My father was he was not a farmer, but he has some land. My mother was not a farmer. She has some business. She sell things. She's a petty sellers. My parents got divorced when I was 2 years old, so I don't know very much about father. Mother takes care of all four children.
So you were the youngest.
I am the third. The third.
The third.
Yes, the third, and the only boy.
The only boy.
Yes, yes. So my elder sisters too, and my younger sister. Only I and my younger sister went to university. So you see, my mother worked quite hard. Yes.
So, but then, was it normal in those times for children from the villages to really get so much education? Or was it your mother's idea that you must go to school?
To go to primary school is a duty, yeah, under the law. They don't punish people, but it's a duty. But these days it became compulsory. So in Thailand it's called compulsory education. So, but to go to university is something special. Like in my class, from that school, I think only I went to the university, and it was not that clearly planned, but to get educated is something my mother emphasized. But because of four children, so mother had to sell things in the market. And I think the way she made the living was recognized by her elder brother, some of the elder brothers. One who lives in Chiang Rai, near the border, or with Lao and Burma. That elder brother was a bit concerned, so ask my mother to get me staying with him. So from middle school onwards, I stayed with my uncle in that area. My uncle was a manager of a factory, so I stayed with him, with the workers of the factory in Chiang Rai. That's how I had my high school, my middle school and high school. And in Chiang Rai, some of you may not know, it is very diverse in terms of nationalities too, because of hill tribes, because of neighboring province, because of easy travel across the borders. So it is in some way it is quite multicultural by nature. And but the Chiang Rai is during my youth, it took one whole day if I go from home in Lamphun to Chiang Rai. So at that I have uncle in two places around that region, two uncles. So my mother was helped by my elder brothers. So her burden was lessened. So every day, every year, I would be in school over there, but coming back home only 2 months. So I was away from home, from mother, like that. Since I was 9 years or 10 years old, after my middle, my primary school, yeah.
So the first time when you were sent to your uncle,
yeah,
how did you feel? Were you happy or were you really sad that you were leaving your mother?
Oh, that feeling, I was. When my uncle came to our home at that time, I still remember the story. I because we were rural, I was very kind of afraid of uncle. So I went down, you know, our home has built high, like in Thailand, because of sometimes water comes down. So I went, I fled to under the house. And mother has to call me up to see uncle like that. Talking that, okay, now you go to uncle, okay, to study. That will be good for your life. I did not want to go. I don't want to leave home. But anyway, we were young, that young, so I was not like rebelling in that mood, but I did not want to go. I was afraid of my uncle and my uncle is quite a commanding personality, because he was a manager and he has more urban experience than other uncles. And in some way he also better off because he could send at least one or two of his kids to universities. Yeah, later even three, I think, yeah. So he was kind enough to help my mother in that way. He and his elder brother in another province nearby, I think they agreed with my mother that they will help to lessen the burden of my mother. Because my mother was taking care of the grand mother. Mm. My mother is the smallest, the youngest daughter of seven people in the family, and the home where she lived, where we were living, was the home of the, it's like the main home of everyone. So we, like when we have to pray for our grandparents, the deceased people, we have all these things at the home. Like Chinese New Year, like Cheng Meng. Yes. So in a way, every year people will come to the home like that for ceremony, for, you know, religious to pray and to have ceremonies for the dead parents. Yeah.
Did your grandparents migrate to that place? Or?
Yes, yes. Grandpa migrated from China. I don't know from where. I only remember him vaguely because we lost him when I was around 2 years old. I remember very vaguely. Grandma was half, maybe half Thai, half Chinese. Grandma, she only told us a lot about grandpa. But anyway, in that part of Thailand, there were a few people who were migrant from China, and it was quite natural that these migrant people do something in making living and having married to the locals. Yes, yes. And in some way we were among few families who do business and also who are known to be having some Chinese culture, or Chinese, not Chinese culture, but at least some New Year and also Cheng Meng events. But otherwise, we just go to the same temple, we just go to the same school, like that, yeah. My home is very close to the market, yeah. So every morning, I just go, when I was that small, I went to with my mother. Mother will go to market to sell things very early, and if we get up, we go, yeah.
But still, she could just barely manage to feed all the children, keep the home.
For people of our times, I think it's not easy to imagine how a mother who could do that and still maintain livelihoods of children and also her mother, and also her elder sister living with her. So they were my home, all ladies except myself. Yes, yes. So she did not have much money, but she managed very well. Yeah.
So Muto, please come.
Oh, Muto.
please come here.
So
we are learning about her childhood story.
Oh. Please. The first 1 hour owned 50 hours.
I see.
Oh,
yes, yes.
With the 50 hours, I hope. Yes.
Yes, yes. Okay. So my mother would tell me some story like this. Because she was needed to look after children of the elder sisters, she was not supported to study at all. So my mother would tell one story that make her very proud. She said, she was already, I think, or maybe something like 15 or something. She said, I was helping to raise the, you know, my grand children, you know, in some way, son or daughters of the elder brothers who live nearby. We live in a big compound in Lamphun. Eldest brother, because seven children, eldest who is quite educated and okay in the local area, became something like a leader of the local community and others. And so she was busy raising the kids, and but she was not promoted, supported to go to school. So my mother at one day, because she became 14, 15, she feel, she think this is, she decided one day, she said, talk to her father and mother, if you don't allow me to go to school, she spoke this in front of the elder brothers, if you don't allow me to go to school, and I'm getting old, I will leave the house. I will leave. And by that, by saying so, they said, okay, if you want to go to school, okay, we let you go. So she managed to go to primary school and finish a third grade. That is all education she got, third grade. Not even the whole primary school. But she managed to write well, and also I think she by her own way of making livelihoods, I think she also educated herself. So that was a very proud part, story of pride, that she could rebel against the elder brothers and against her and her. You know, her father and mother was also kind of supporting her, but with unclear from the start. So okay, if you want to go, and everyone, so in that way she has been accepted as a smallest child of the family, but has certain duty for the parents, because in our context, the youngest daughter usually takes care of father and mother. In Thai culture, it usually ends up like that. Youngest daughter, in terms of taking care of father and mother, that would so that was the case. So my growing up experience have some. You know, gaps, have some experience of gaps between relationship with cousins, because I am from in a way the lowest status among all the seven brothers and sisters of my mother. I mean, rural, less educated, and economically not so. Compared with other brothers who live in the urban area or do some business, and but my mother was, in a way, quite tough sometimes.
And you have inherited that in your character?
I don't know. Maybe. I think all of our children, I think, learn from mother. Yeah. Because she alone has to. You know, deal with these four kids, and my father, after divorced, he got married to, and also had about three or four children. But all those children became a very good friends with us. Yes.
So you still saw him after he left?
Yeah, I saw him sometimes. Every time I go to see him, not too far away. Maybe by bicycle, about less than 2 kilometers. He lived near the my temple school. Yeah. So that's why I know the children. Like we still go to each other. The three children, two still living, the other one died. And they became very, you know, very good relationship with my mother. So in some way, no bad feeling. But my father was quite you know, he when you ask me what was he doing, he's quite I think quite someone who went through some education, and also I think he was a monk for a certain period, so he has good knowledge. But when you ask me what kind of living he was doing, I have no clear idea. I have no clear idea what he was doing for living. But one thing I remember is that he likes chicken fight. He would raise a lot of some chicken for and that was a part that my mother, to some level, she could not accommodate. She's so, she loved him so much that she fled away from home to go with him. My mother loved him so much, and they had four children within about 4 years of marriage. You see, 4 or 5 years of marriage. But somehow she made a decision that she had not live. So that was the part that I remember about our parents. And I lost my father when I was in second year of Chula studies, already at the university. But we have not lived with each other since when I was 2 years old. My mother would tell me like that, because we are living near the market. Whenever some people look like my father, I would call, "Father, father." Yeah, something like, I don't know. She would say, call for our father, and she told me, you often call people who look like your father, father, father. So, okay. Laughingly, but it so that's maybe that helped also partly our uncle were kind to us to help facilitate the burdens of my mother. But anyway, my mother was quite quite focused in making our children, make sure that all the children went to finish high school, everyone. Only the first one, maybe she could not make it. But so middle school finished.
So right after high school, then you went to Japan to study?
Oh.
Did you study university in Japan or?
In my high school, our days, there were English teacher who are from Peace Corps. American Peace Corps, and anyway, because my home was in that region, Lumpur area, I kind of I just tell us one story. Before I finished the last year of high school, I thought I wanted to finish my final 2 years of high school in my local area, near home. So, my home to my school, it's 14 kilometers. So every morning we would go by bicycle from home to high school. And there are quite a few people who do like that. So we go in the morning, something like 7 in the morning, go to the, you know, 6:30 or 7, go to high school. So it's like every morning, 14 kilometers afterwards, like that. And also, I was not performing that well in that school. I thought, oh, maybe I cannot end in a good, if I want to go to university. So in that period, I thought maybe I should move back to Chiang Rai again, because maybe I should concentrate in my last year of high school. If I don't do that, I think it will not be possible to enter any university. Now, because I had a good English teacher, okay, an American. The American who taught me at that time, I could not remember that well, but later, when I became a lecturer at Chula, he became a U.S. ambassador. Okay, this is some a part of story. But because of my good impression of my teacher and the English language, and I was kind of eager to learn. So I often ride my bike to go to public library, borrow any English book at the library, which is, there is one public library in a good temple about maybe 5 or 6 kilometers from home. But I like that library. So I made friends with the librarian, I borrow books, and so I read English books, try to make sense of all these things, because of that kind of inspiration from English. And I started to listen to Voice of America, you know. Yeah. Maybe because of that kind of experience made me interested in competing for student exchange scholarships. So this is what made me pass one American Field Service selection. And that was in the last year of high school in Chiang Rai that I was. It was 1965. Yeah, 65. And that was the year examination selection was on, and my final year of the high school. In my high school, there were about 700 plus ladies, girls' school, provincial girls' school. But for the first year, they have started only the final 2 years of high school, they would get boys. So there were only 5 boys in the whole university, in the whole school. So anyway, in that environment, I had another teacher, because I moved to that school, another teacher at that time, who is not anymore a Peace Corps, but I think I had a good training from my high school, my English Peace Corps teacher. So that selection made me. It affected me after I entered Chula, because after entrance examination, in that period, because Bangkok, I don't know anyone. So I asked mother, I will have to go to examination. But before examination, we have to go to some prep school, maybe what, 2 months, to make get some confidence. So and one of my cousin, lives in a temple in Bangkok, the marble temple, which is well known, beautiful. But it is also a home of the northern monks for Bangkok, and there are, a few monastery house separately for monks, and one of those were people from my region, and the head of that small part took my cousin as one of people who helped him. So I stayed with that monk and also did some help. And so staying there, I went to a prep school, and prep school for about two months. Then we had examination. I finished my high school, what they call science high, not arts high. Although I was quite okay in terms of arts and history and civics, but I was not too bad in science. But I did not like physics. I like biology, like something like that. So I had no confidence whether I studied science in university or arts. I had no clear idea. Anyway, when I asked people, all kinds of advice, not clear. So when I was not sure, when I did not pass through the prep courses, I took all the entrance examination in Chula, in Thammasat, all the arts. And then when I got better prepared after my prep 2 months, I took, okay, now I enter science, but not too high for my possibility. So I went to 5 examinations to make sure I can enter. And anyway, like in the agricultural university, National Agricultural University, I didn't want to go too high. I went to about a second, that is forestry. Okay. In Chiang Mai University, I did not go to medical. I go or dentistry, a bit too high. So I went to science. If I can do it better, I can pass somewhere there, like that. So it was that experience. But anyway, that kind of first time in Bangkok, first time exposed to competition like that, and it was a good learning experience for people like me. Staying in the temple, you save a lot of money, yeah? And mother did not have to be too burdened about it. So, and also looked after by cousin, who went to Thammasat. Anyway, among that, I didn't even know the difference between Thammasat and Chula. I went to all this. And when I go to see the result examination, some of my friends who are still my friends today would tell me what is the difference between Thammasat and Chula. And they say, if you get both, you should go to Chula. I said, oh, I don't know, because Thammasat is somewhere more well known. Chula, okay, I don't know. So anyway, I decide, okay, Chula, okay, good, okay. And those are still my, good friends, because they were kind to me. As you know, northern people speak dialects, not similar to Bangkok. I was shy. I only smiled. So people were also kind to me. Oh, those days, it was nice. And okay, you could imagine a little. But anyway, I entered university for about 2 months, 2 or 3 months, because of my selection as an exchange student for American Field Service. I asked for permission to leave for 1 year to abroad, study abroad, and it was permitted. It was, they always permit students who got scholarships to go. So that was how I went the first time abroad. And I went to, and I did not pay, we did not pay any money. Some people were asked to pay. I think the selection committee did not ask for any money from our family. So I went to, among There were about 100 people during my period. That time, I went to Minnesota.
Really?
For the first time. And Minnesota, I had no idea about Minnesota. Anyway, I was in small mining town in the northern Minnesota, and you can imagine it's a little cold. Cool. 1 year, yes, but it was, And I remember well, because from rural to urban to Bangkok, you already have some kind of culture shock. And when you go to Minnesota, it's also more. So I did not speak much for 2 or 3 months. I'm a bit shy, you know.
You went to university there?
It was high school. The last year of high school in Minnesota. So you see, because the exchange scholarship was only for high school.
High school. Before you entered Chula.
I already entered Chula. What I have to tell, it was with the already 1 year in already starting the first 2 months in university, whether I should go to study English again in high school, that was also a point of thinking. Should I drop the scholarship or should I just go to the US? But I thought maybe for people like me, I should find some new experience. Some people just drop the scholarship. But for me, I think I should like to see the world. So, okay, I went. And no pay, that's good. I go to foreign country. Oh, that's excellent. So I decided to go.
And in Minnesota, you were going to high school.
Yes, last year of high school. Yes. Last year of high school, stay with American family and looked after by this scholarship called American Field Service. And I was in a Catholic house, a Polish descent. So I was there and go to the church every Sunday. So I was in a different cultural context. Yes. And that was also quite first time in a foreign country, first time in like that, and completely different religion, and also learn and. Okay, that has some impact. That was 66 to 67. It was under Lyndon B. Johnson.
Yes.
American War. Yes. But I had no idea about the kind. I was, in the mainstream atmosphere. So I know there were a Vietnam War going on, and but anyway, The brother, American brother who lived in the house, already started his university, first or second year of university. He went to education at University of Minnesota. I learned from some of his books. So I read some anthropology book in the house.
Brother? Your brother?
Old American brother.
The host family.
yes. American. Anyway, I learned a little about anthropology then, and I already had some idea. I want to be working at university, a teacher of university, when I was decided which field I should go to the university. I decided not to go to science. Or go to social science. I thought, okay, I want to go along this line, maybe. So that was the, and then the American experience made me feel more that, I think this is confirmed. My field, and that in my political science entry, I still could select what field: diplomacy, politics. Public administration or sociology and anthropology. So I select the last one, the least popular among the three. Anyway, in my, I came back and there were, in my class, there were three people who went to the same American experience. One from the South and one from Central. And in this context of AFS, you know, there's Surin Pisuan, who is 1 year younger than I. Surin, the ASEAN Secretary General, who younger, but so we made friends during, because he's from another province in the South. And anyway, it was another experience that may be important for me, exposed to education and also culturally completely new context. So I came back to Chula. Maybe that also made me a bit confident, because of, you know, you people won't believe it. I did not dare to speak the Bangkok language that much. I have to tell you, in my high school in Lamphun, before I moved to Chiang Rai, I still have remember this very well. You see, we cannot ask the teacher in the room in our own language. We have to ask in Bangkok standard language. And if I slip a few words, one word would cost me 25 satangs. That means 4 words, 1 baht. You would be fined, punished. So that is how we were discouraged to use our own language in classrooms. In Lamphun. It's everywhere in Thailand, but my experience in Lamphun.
That was primary school.
That was my high school, yeah, later. Like grade 11 or grade 10 or 11. And I still remember it. And so, you see, if I ask in Central Thai language, my friends will laugh, because usually we laugh at each other speaking, you know, not good Thai, standard Thai, but we speak in our own tone, dialect. So it's, you know, either way you are punished by something. I was not happy. I was something wrong. I was not happy. But, you know, in my class there was someone who was very good, make a very good grade, who made me feel that, oh, I have to reconsider myself, that I made to move to another university, because another high school, to Chiang Rai. But anyway, I wanted to mention that because in the class, so there were, we don't dare to speak in public, but we speak in our language, yeah? So it was like that. So when I talk about my experience with standard Thai language, when I went to Bangkok, that's some kind, you know, you don't have confidence. But you also don't have confidence in your English. But anyway, I discovered that I was among the first for my class, about 100 selected students, I was among the first group who had. There were group among the English, the top English achievement test. I was among the first group. So my friends were kind to me, who explained to me about Chula and Thammasat. They were in that group too. So we, okay, somehow we had some small confidence. But I still, maybe my American experience made me feel more confident to have some level of communication with the Bangkok students, Bangkok students. So anyway, that was the cultural background.
And when did you go to Japan?
Oh, that was after my graduation from Chula. Because of my American experience, maybe, although I study in Thailand, and my generation, our generation was under military rule. Chula president was General Prapat.
What?
Prapat, yes. Achan Muto would remember all these names because those days, my education was with Ampo. I often go to Ampo, and he would know all these very major political figure. There were two. They were the one who made coup d'etat in 1971, and anyway the reason that we get to know all this because his name became a focus of student revolution in 73. Chendra Papad was the president of Chulalongkorn University at that time. You can get the atmosphere of our generation. It's you know, you cannot assemble by five people, you cannot talk much, but anyway, I was involved with the rural development clubs to the rural area, so we have gatherings. And it was so, but we have to be a bit careful. So all these things. Now, my generation, no one would like to study in Thailand. If they can, they want to study abroad. No one want to continue education. Because freedom, no freedom. And also we are eager to know the world. So most of my friends would go to the US or England or Australia. And it was natural to think like that. But for myself, I was kind of thinking that it's easy to go to the US. But I don't know anything about this region. I wanted to know something about India. Because we are so influenced by Indian culture, Buddhist, Sanskrit, and also I was interested in China, in Japan. These two countries impressed me to as someplace something I would like to know about, and also relationships in some way. So when you know, I was not the best student in my class, because I do some activities like this. But I was among the what would be called a good student in my department because I talk a lot with my teachers. And they know I'm from rural area, they are kind to me, you know. So they give advice to me, Surichai, you should go to the US. You should go to English, and then you... And one of my teacher who is a very... He's one of the strong personality on campus. The Chula is a somewhat a medical and science strength. Social science, arts, okay, but in terms of those days, today is much more clearer. We are science and medical. Social science, we have become weakened. But in my day, it was not that. But anyway, I want to mention that because all of my teachers, most except one, would say you should go to the West to. Because advanced knowledge in sociology, anthropology, and one say, because he finished from University of Chicago, he said, if you want to go to the U.S., I have scholarship for you for social demography to do until your PhD. But I am not interested at all in population studies. I am so boring. I said, thank you, But, and it's good university. I think when I check, it's good university, but I don't want to study population. So I said, okay, like that. And some other people, some from Cornell, some, you know. But anyway, I didn't want to go to the US. I don't know why, I was so much interested in either India or Japan. Because there are some interesting questions in my mind. We cannot get answer from our experience in classroom or readings. I want to know why India has come this way and change that way. And Japan, the question was why Japan developed so fast. I was into, and some people of my teacher, among my teachers, say we started the same process of modernization at the same time. That's what he say. They talk about Meiji Revolution, Meiji Restoration, and King Chulalongkorn with the Western powers. That was okay because of colonialism, because of modernization, unification of the country. The period of our modernization started at the same time, they say, the teacher said. Anyway, I was okay. Japan, because we already have a lot of Japanese electronics and even pencils we buy from Japan, Mitsubishi pencils, and they have songs, you know. I still remember those. Anyway, so I the examination of for scholarships for India, for Japan, I went to the examination. We don't have money anyway. So I was eager. I was only among my classmates who went to Japanese examination. But another friend of mine who also have same interest went to Indians examination. The result of examination of the Japan scholarship Mambusho was earlier announced. And then I checked more interest about Japan. I said, okay, maybe I will go to Japan. So I talked with my teacher who said, yeah, Surichai, I think Japan may be interesting. But you must, this teacher said, you cannot study in English. You must study in Japanese. Are you sure you are interested? You have to spend more than ordinary times. I said, I think I will go to Japan because of this teacher. Anyway, this teacher was among the two teachers who was cooperating with Tominaga Kenichi.
Oh. My classmate.
Yeah, very, very, very different kind.
Polemical adversary.
Very different kind, very different kind. Anyway, that's let because he came to Thailand to do some stratification study, social stratification, and my teacher, two of them, and he Tominaga Sensei's friend is one of his friend at Harvard. He met one person who. Who is a socialist, kind of sociologist, but also a socialist, a Thai. And that person is from my northern part. And his mother was indirectly my teacher in the high school over there, okay? So the last name is Punyotayana. Punyotayana, the first name is Bunsanong. Anyway, Tominaga-san, Bunsanong, maybe you can recall the name, yeah. Bunsanong, Dr. Bunsanong, a PhD from Cornell. And I think Cornell sometimes have some interaction with the Harvard people. And I think because Tominaga-san went to Harvard for some period of research, so they met there. And they became friends of some interest. Because Bunsanong was interested in Japan's social change, and he was interested in the class mobility or individual mobility of Japan modernization or something like that. Anyway, that's the relationship that later I've discovered about Tomina Sensei's and Muto Sensei's relationship of some kind. But anyway, so when I decided to go to Japan, my teachers at Chula said, yeah, Bunsen, Tominaga, someone called Tominaga came to us and get some cooperation with us to do research. So you can contact him. So I somehow contacted Tominaga Sensei. Well, I think I didn't contact. I just write his name in my application, I think. because they say, where do you want to do your master's? I just write a few names. I don't have clear idea what it is. But okay, I just follow my teachers. That's where I went to Japan in 71. And 72, when I was in Japan, I already learned that in Thailand, every day during some period, anti-Japanese goods boycott movement in Thailand. And my friend were among those people who protest. So at that time, there were some Todai students made friends with me somewhere, and they were helping us to translate our documents from Bangkok, from Thai language to Japanese. It was Suehiro. Suehiro, who later became a very good expert on Thai economy and also interested in democratization movement. He was also a little different from ordinary, very, very, you know, egocentric type. At least Suehiro taught me Japanese. We had study group with Suehiro, and that part of my learning of Todai was maybe more meaningful than classrooms. So why I came to Japan, and how I later. My learning outside classroom became more dominant in my personal interest. So I had a very, very much tension in my contradicts because my interest is a little not like a debate on the German translated text of Weber and like that. And while there are Japanese goods boycott movement happening in Thailand and some thing all going on lively in the society, so I kind of had to pressure myself to sit in the room and do report and translate all these things in the class. But that was my experience.
Were you already sort of leftist thinker by the time you arrived in Japan?
Not quite.
What's your sort of ideological orientation?
Oh.
During Chula time?
I think from Chula time, maybe I would use the word maybe progressive. Maybe, you know, want to change democratic interest in democratization of some kind, concern about gaps of development, Bangkok and the rural areas, and concern about the way the military used power like that. I was not very happy if people go to be obedient to the people in power, something like that, that kind of attitude. But I was not very clear. I did not read that much. But somehow already it came to the back door of my reading, maybe, because some good writings in Thai language started to appear among our friends. And I was influenced maybe...
Yes.
Okay, this part of this was very important. Maybe the extracurricular activities that I had, apart from being a student at sociology department, political science, was I was involved with rural development work, rural development activities, which were organized outside campus. It was inter-university network. And that was already since my second year of university. The year I returned from the US, I was a student, but I also work outside university with this network of inter-university people for rural issues. Uh-huh. And that was where...
Was it connected with the inner city or...
Partially. And it was related to quite a few progressive people. Like the one advisor of ours was the one who got his studies from Beijing University. He died too soon. His name was Sot Kuramaruhit. He is a respected personality in Thai intellectual and writers world. Ajahn Sulak knew him, but he died too soon. He was one of our advisors for the rural development camp. He gave us spaces of discussion. At you remember, there's a student Christian center.
Yes.
Yeah, the person lives there.
Quaker?
He is. He's not a Quaker. He has no direct. Religious background relation to SEC, but somehow I don't know why he lived in the same compound, but he is well-known writer, award-winning writer. He was among his generation a very few Royal Thai student scholarship person who went to study in Beijing. The others went to Europe during his period. And when he returned from Beijing, already the China became fully revolutionized. When he studied, it was under the big transformation from during those period of affected after Sun Yat-sen started the revolution. But he went to China, Beijing, during the Kuomintang and Mao struggle. So he was very much
influenced.
He was old. He was our advisor for the rural development group until, I think, he was nearly 70, but he died of heart attack. Ajahn Sot Kuramaruhit. So he was one among the personalities. We went Sot Kuramaruhit.
Sot Kuramaruhit.
Yes, Kuramaruhit. Yes. And through him we learn thinking about some contemporary thinkers of Thailand of his period. Who were, because Thailand became more Cold War ally and the atmosphere was not so much welcome for him to be in the public offices. So I think he had to struggle a lot. So he became more and more independent in some way because of this, I think. So he devoted a lot of work for agricultural cooperatives, thinking as one solution for social organization of Thailand in the context of capitalism like that. And we remember well. And he also was, because he was that kind of thinking, I think Ajahn Sulak knew him well, and he also was open for us to know other people like Ajahn Pue Ung Pakorn, who was a bank governor of Thailand, who was also very person of integrity, who was almost pushed out by the military. But I think they recognized that would cost them too much, so they, and he was not antagonistic to them, but he was a man of principle of independent central bank management. So, in some way, they learn about that important principle through his integrity. Anyway, he was the president of Thammasat during. During the student democratization period, and he was pushed very harshly after October 6 massacre, and he was even physically attacked by certain police general. So he left Thailand after October 6th. Puai Ung Pakorn. Puai Ung Pakorn, yes. And he
to
England, yes, yes. So this man was the one of the most respected intellectual of the time, and he was much respected by Ajahn Sulak.
Surumi was very close to him.
Oh. So I, Ajahn Sulak was a major figure in my informal learning at the university because of the social science review. He, I think, because of his style, is all, whatever it is, he pays a lot of attention to new generation of people. He is unkind to, you know, the same generation of people, but he is very kind to the young. He would give a lot of attention to interest in his eyes, interesting young ones. So he support whatever they want to do. This is the I think we look back at this is the most one of the most important thing that we can do for the new generation. He I think Ajahn Sulak has given space for us to discuss and protect us from whatever power that may have negative may impact on us or disable us to think. He would encourage us and encourage us to translate something out of Thai context to us to learn, and like the issue of Vietnam War. It's I think yes, please.
Very good. Yeah, it's very good that you are here.
Yes, please.
And coffee. But then at the same time, would you like to get some coffee?
Oh, yes, yes.
Some coffee,
please. Yes, yes, please. If he opens, I will start.
Yes, yes. Please start.
But you
have no. These are the questions we would like to ask.
So it's a dialogue. Yes. So, yes. Thank you, Muto Sensei. Yes.
Maybe take your breakfast first.
My first time to hear from him about his great because when he showed up, I don't remember when it was exactly.
Oh.
Already he was an activist and he was he represented almost the Thai revolutionary movement. That's the impression I had. So
that, I think that was but I really learned a lot from Ampo. Ampo experience, Ampo library. You have all kinds of the things that I wanted to see and read, and so that was my really exciting, like the Latin American journals, like that. So Chinese related and different ways of looking at China in those days. Vietnam War, different ways of seeing Vietnam War. In Thailand, you never see. So those kind of, you know, seeing it. But I could only read English when I visited your place. And the library was very, Kachi-san was very kind to me. And you took it. Yes. Yes, so those days was very nice, yes. Very different atmosphere than library at Todai.
But I don't remember how you came into the Ampo circle.
Oh.
Do you remember how the connections, by who's into that?
I think Surumi-san.
Surumi-san.
Maybe one of the environment that created me to open my eyes or reaching out to Ampo related people, because you know Sulak Sensei. Sulak Sensei, whenever he came to Japan, he would meet at least when I met him, I would meet him around my house. And when he came, he would talk to us late in the night. Sometimes just sleep in his room. He sleep and we sleep on the floor, you know, several of us. And because of the Thai political situation of the 70s, apart from Thai's relationship with Vietnam War, we had a military government for very a long period, and so our people who came to study in Japan almost all are affected by that atmosphere of Thailand. So we were not happy. We want to know something more, and so the active ones get together, became association. So we have our meetings often. Oh, there are some important meetings that I encountered and that made me in trouble too. You know, in 73, for example, 73 student level, but to respond to you, to you maybe because of the experience from Thailand made us reaching out to book new ideas of change. And I think to listen to Ajahn Sulak, who meet other interesting people, made us feel that interesting things is going on when he meet people like that. And so he shared with us a lot of inside stories when we talk with him in the night. That's where I met Surumi-sang too. And Surumi-sang is not has a different a little different personality from Ajahn Sulak. But still he was kind to us. He would say, he would advise us to go what and or meet whom. So that's where we, I think going to Ampo was very natural. For me, for our friends then.
Tsurumi-san was Tsurumi Yoshiyuki. And he was one of the few important persons in the Heian movement. And he was, at that time, program officer of the International House. International House is a Rockefeller Foundation funded post-war sort of outfit. And well, it's still there, and manages various international exchanges and so on. And depending on the persons who are working there, plays a very positive role. Tsurumi was there using the function of the International House. It's called I House, promoting exchanges and facilitating, for instance, Asian People's Conference.
Yes.
In 74.
Oh yes, yes, yes.
And Surichai also.
Yes.
So that's the background. And at that time, we had very good contacts with Thai friends. I mean, 73, when student
revolution.
Student revolution. Then the leader.
Tanaka.
The Chirayut.
Ah, Chirayut. Yes, 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 yes. Came to Thailand. Came to Japan.
Came to Japan. it was Tsurumi who.
Yes, yes, yes.
Heard about that. And you were there already.
I was in Japan already. Yes, yes,
already.
Yes,
and,
yes.
They went to Haneda Airport to catch him at the airport and fetched him to Inamata. Because he was invited by an association, Asian Students Association, some Asian student something, no? Which is an official organization with Nakasone as chairperson. So it was not just in line with the student revolution. So we climbed and persuaded
Chirayut, yes.
At the airport.
Yes, took him to Minamata.
Yes. And Tsurumi did it. This kind of thing.
Yes. Chirayut, that Muto Sensei mentioned, was the leader of the Japanese goods boycott movement. He was an engineering student from Chulalongkorn University. So I think they were clever. Huh? They were invited. Inviting him, but he was taken to Minamata. Yes, I think Tanya and Prayun went together with him. Yes, I could not go then. Yes, but we were together. Yes.
Tanya and Prayun, members of your.
We are the same group.
High students association.
Yes, yes, yes.
In Japan, how many are there?
we form our group after the student revolution in Bangkok in October 73. Yeah? But in fact, before that, we had study groups already because of our repression happened in Thailand, because of many, sometimes very sad stories, sometimes very challenging issues like the American base. So we had weekly meeting, and sometimes key people from Thailand comes, so we would invite the person to speak. Ajahn Sulak was one among those, for us, was we learned the situation from elderly people who came from Bangkok. We, by that, I think the group became more and more as a group who are concerned about political and also social direction of Thailand. So in that, some among us were already familiar with Minamata issues. I was even quite some steps behind my friend like Prayun and Yuadi, who were so familiar with Minamata and Itai issues. And so they told me every often about all these things. And so anyway, our group were composed of students who were affected by the environment of Japan and of the Asia and also our own country. So the group became formally formed as in Thai language it would be Kho To Po. It is student group for Thai to struggle for Thai democracy, like that. So it was formally formed after we went to the embassy in October 14 and 15th. The students of Thailand who came to Japan during that time saw and heard about the events in Thailand. They decided to come to the embassy. So maybe nearly 100 were at the embassy, and the embassy people didn't know what to do with the students. In a way, they were also worried that this student may take a siege of the university, of the embassy. But that also was important point. So we were all together, the key members were more than something like maybe 15, 20, but we were also all over Japan then. So,
in
yeah.
The embassy thing is
73. And then after that, democratization period. And 76 was the worst thing ever happened to us, and because we watched this on television, students were shot in front of our eyes, and that radicalized. That 3 years radicalized the student in Japan, because we witnessed Thailand from outside, and we see how the students were, you know, just ordinary students were treated by military in very bad ways. And so authorities were being viewed more objectively by the students. And anyway, I think we turned more progressive, more study about reading Mao Zedong's writing or Lenin's writing, or reading other things happening in Latin America, like Paulo Freire and all these things. So we were interested different kind of social and political change, and also the events in China much affected our studies. Also the world situation, Vietnam. We made friends with Vietnamese students in Japan. So we learned indirectly about this, and also we learned about Korea, Korean students' experience. Just I think in 74, our study group about student struggle in Korea. We did some study, and we write a small book together. And that was published in Thailand by Thiriyut and his friends. So, you know, that learning from Korean student revolution was the book. And so, and also like Japan, you know, polluted Japan. Polluted Japan as a book in Thai language was written by student study group in Japan. So that period, we really, my friends, Prayun, URD, Kengkat, yes, Tanya, all these people, and some people in these names were back Tokyo, but there were other names in Kyoto, some in Tohoku. So that we had this kind of studies and division of labor, but we often have a meeting together. So that made our learning of Japanese experience, Korean democratization experience under military rule before Park Chung-hee came into power, and then Park Chung-hee came into power, and all these stories where we try to study and made it in Thai language. So I think those Tanya is quite unique among us. Tanya was secretary general of that group. I was not. Tanya, he is a writer himself. He is also good in communicating in terms of writing to the public. He was also a kind of backing our efforts to relay to the public in Thailand. He said, so in that way, I think Tanya was recognized well, and we asked him to be Secretary General of the Thai residents in Japan struggling for democracy group. And Prayun was kind of thinker, strategic, and more informed about Japan than, because I was a bit newer than Prayun. Also, we share the same generation. Prayun had his undergrad education here. Mm-hmm. So these people are so fluent in Japanese. Mm-hmm. Tanya and I came only 71. So we were new, we were green. But getting educated through all this exposure in Japan, Ui Sensei, you know, we learned about Ui Jun Sensei, who until his retirement from Todai was only assistant. But he was so well known. He was so powerful in terms of social thinking about pollution in Japan. And I think we also learned that aspect of Todai, that aspect of Japanese university from the personality of Ui Jun Sensei of some kind. And later we learn about that you were in Todai, and we learn also that you did not want to finish your studies in Todai, you just do it on 1 or 2 years. That's what I had the memory. I remember you mentioned about my advisor, Tominaga Sensei. You did not give very clear or no positive, but like, okay, a professor at Todai, but my generation, you mentioned something like that to me. But I think the world of the academic in Japan was so institutionalized. Unbelievable. And I learned about that. So strong and so separate from the real, from the real issues. People in between, like Ui Jun Sensei, has to struggle. And he could achieve it because of his personality. Without it, without his support from some people, I think the public space of university would not be used for meaningful purpose. So that part of Jichukosa, I also learned that maybe indirectly what I have been trying to do, what some friends of ours in Thailand who are in university with that experience try to do, is university must be public. That is, if university don't give attention to public space in engagement, in learning, I think university has no relevance. So that's how we learn in this kind of fast-paced changes. So in Japan, that indirectly, how we learn. So in that context, there are some like I learned more from after I went to Ampo. I went often. Yeah. I borrow books. I sometimes translate things to share with my friend. Make it as a study document in our study group. That's how we study about, say, progressive movements in the region.
Edited the whole issue in Thai coup,
coup d'etat. somehow, yes. I was not that kind of self-confident person. But anyway, I was, Muto-san and Kaji-san and other friends make me more confident that maybe we can do something like that. And because our networking with Thai movements, people, friends, and so we were able, and people like Tanya, people like Ai Prayun, each have specific skills and also capacity. So made our thinking together, like, okay, maybe we do one issue together like that. And I think we learned a lot from, we were like apprentice at Ampo in some way. And learning about making things, relating to people like that. I mean, because there I met many international people.
Yeah.
You meet, you know, sometimes you meet this and that, and when we go demonstration, there was some experience in Japan at that time. Because foreign students were not allowed easily to go demonstration. If you are foreign scholarship students, there was one item in the rule when we accept the scholarship that we should abide by.
That is
Yeah, because a scholarship, government scholarship from Japan. And we, because of the events in October 14th, student revolution, really shocked all of us that something interesting, something exciting, but we also lost a lot of friends. So at that time, some people were killed, and so we said, we decided to go demonstration in Tokyo. And that period, the first time for us to encounter with police in Japan, when you go demonstration, that was the first experience. And it was quite tough, but we were helped, facilitated by Japanese colleagues who also took the opportunity to relate to democratic movement in our region. And we were supported by Vietnamese students too, supported by people who work with the Vietnam War. So that was a very, very good entry into this experience. And then I remember, because Dr. Bun Sanong Bun Yotayana, the person whom I, who during that, before October 6, 76, we had a very good, very progressive movement in Thailand, where Dr. Bun Sanong was, I think he was also transforming himself during the progressive days of democratization. He was a part of the establishment of Socialist Party of Thailand. He became the Secretary General of the party, while he was also a lecturer at Thammasat University. And Dr. Bun Sanong was coming to Japan around October 3rd or October 4th. There were something called Asian Sociologist Conference, organized by Japan Sociological Society. And he was one of the speakers. But he, because of the events in Thailand turned very blood deadly, yeah? He decided to go back before the conference started. The conference would be starting sometime October, I don't know, October 15, October 16, or something like that. He was there coming to Japan, ready to go to the conference, but he decided to go back before anything started. But we were with him. He was with Syed Hussein Ali from Malaysia, who is a mentor of all these friends in Malaysia of today. Syed Hussein Ali, I think you remember well too. Yes, he is a respected anthropologist from Malaysia, University of Malaya. He later became, he is a generation of Mahathir, but he was imprisoned by Mahathir. Anyway, we met Bun Sanong and Syed Hussein Ali at the Homaba student discussion room. We invited them to speak to our students. And we learned for the first time about Malaysia from Syed Hussein Ali, as well as about Thailand from Chan Bun Sanong, who in 1 or 2 days, I think, decided to go back to Thailand without joining the real meeting. So my teacher, Tominaga Sensei, said, "Surichai, can you read the text of Bun Sanong on his behalf?" I said, okay, I will try to do it. But somehow, the student group in Tokyo, in Japan, decided that we have to go to demonstrate and pay our respect to the killed, the deceased in the movement in October Revolution. And we have to go demonstrate in Bangkok, in Tokyo, the same day. So I had to tell my teacher, I cannot do it. Sorry that made my teacher not so happy. But anyway, the event. So that that was the first experience of demonstration. It was more, increasingly we had more activities or political activities in Tokyo, in Japan at that time. Solidarity.
After that, he was killed, right?
Yes. Yes. You see, I was, it was in 1975. When he became more vocal, when he became a part of the Socialist Party of Thailand, and some part of the establishment killed him. He was assassinated in Bangkok, just somewhere near some well-known hotel near the airport. And
near the airport. Yes,
I was
on his way to the airport.
Yeah. And because we became familiar with him when he visited our meeting in Tokyo, so we all remembered him very well. And that day I learned about his assassination. I was with Tominaga Sensei's house. I was invited to his house because, you see, I sometimes go to my sensei's house because he was very kind and he know that he must make me study Japanese language good enough to enter. He would say, so he was very kind in that kind of orientation to me. That day he said, newspaper I just got now, say Bun Sanong was assassinated. He was very sad. He knew Bun Sanong well. He said, Tominaga Sensei also know Bun Sanong was interested in socialism and betterment of Thailand. And he was understood the goodwill of Achan Bun Sanong to our people and the change in the world. But he was very sad that this kind of thing can happen anytime. I think he kind of warned me that you have to be careful too. And so that was a very sad evening. And that evening, for us also, we learned that anything can happen to people in struggle in Thailand, in open space at that time. So that was 75. So this story, because of these killings, assassinations in Bangkok and in the rural areas. And then after that, I think AMPO decided to have the Thai issue. Yes. Already in mind, AMPO was already thinking about it. And so we decided there were killings of peasant leaders.
Yes, peasant leaders.
Yeah, so I was responsible to write an article on peasant leaders killing.
Yes.
Among the team, and at that time we did not dare to use our names because we don't know what would happen, but something serious happening, and that's how we learn about how to make our understanding in written forms and communicating to the public, and not only to our own people but communicated to the region. So that's how we learn mutually in the region about the regional issues across the borders.
Likewise, ECJ and
France,
you were together.
Yes, we were together here, yes.